All right, good morning, Lifehouse. How are we this morning? All right, awesome. Let's all stand and worship together. We're going to sing and shout and dance a little bit and praise our God. All right, here we go.
The power of your love running through my heart. Shame has lost its grip on me. The glory of your cross shining on my soul. Grace has got a hold on me from the rooftops. Sing, I'm not ashamed of the one who saved my soul. I'm not ashamed of the one who saved my soul. This fire inside of me is burning for your name. I'm not ashamed, hey, hey. No, I'm not ashamed. Getting stronger, the song is playing louder. We can't hide this love away. There's nothing to fear now. Send us in your power, Jesus. Take us all the way from the rooftops. Say, I'm not ashamed of the one who saved my soul.
Awesome. Well, this is so good to be with you. My name is Cage Queen. I'm actually the worship pastor at Lifehouse Smyrna. And just what an opportunity it is just to worship with you all this morning. You guys have had your coffee, I can tell. Man. Well, it's so good to be here and just a blessing and honor just to get to come before you and lead worship. And man, I'm excited that we have that opportunity just to come before our Father and sing to Him this morning, right? Awesome. Well, would you all turn to one another and just welcome each other? We're excited you're here today. All right, we're gonna sing to Him. We're gonna sing about His amazing grace. Here we go. Who breaks the power? Who breaks the power? shakes the whole earth with holy thunder and leaves us breathless in awe and wonder. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. Doesn't want to make any sound for me. So, man, you guys are just awesome. It's so good. We were blessed last night as a worship team to go up to Bensalem, PA, for a worship conference with Vertical Church. And if you haven't heard any of their worship music, I would encourage you to go check them out. But we do some of their songs here at the church, and they're just awesome worship leaders, and it was so good just to hear wisdom from them. You know, people that have been doing this for a lot longer than I have. And just being able to heed that, but not only their advice, but scriptural advice. And I wanted to share something that really stuck out to me last night. So I'm going to share with you Revelation 4, and then I'll kind of explain. But this is John's vision of heaven. He writes in chapter 4, verse 1, it says, "After this I looked, and behold, a door standing open in heaven. And the first voice which I had heard speaking to me like a trumpet said," and this is Jesus speaking to John, "Come up here, and I will show you what must take place after this. And at once I was in the Spirit, and behold, a throne stood in heaven with one seated on the throne. And he who sat there had the appearance of jasper and carnelian. And around the throne was a rainbow that had the appearance of an emerald. Around the throne were 24 thrones, and seated on the thrones were 24 elders clothed in white garments with golden crowns on their heads. From the throne came flashes of lightning and rumblings of peals of thunder, and before the throne were burning seven torches of fire, which are the seven spirits of God. And before the throne there was, as it were, a sea of glass like crystal. And around the throne, on each side of the throne, are four living creatures, full of eyes in front and behind. The first living creature like a lion, the second living creature like an ox, the third living creature with the face of a man, and the fourth living creature like an eagle in flight. And the four living creatures, each of them with six wings, and are full of eyes all around and within. And day and night they never cease to say," and this is the part that I love, "they never cease to say, 'Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come.' And whenever the living creatures give glory and honor and thanks to him who is seated on the throne, who lives forever and ever, the 24 elders fall down before him who is seated on the throne and worship him who lives forever and ever. They cast their crowns before the throne, saying, 'Worthy are you, our Lord and God, to receive glory and honor and power, for you created all things, and by your will they existed and were created.'" What a ton of stuff is going on in this chapter. I mean, can you imagine seeing all of these things, these creatures that are just full of eyes, and one looks like an ox, and one looks like a man, and the other's like an eagle? But I think what my favorite part is, they never cease to say, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come." And so it's just this perfect picture of heaven. We're not going to stop singing. We're not going to stop worshiping him. And so what Andy from Vertical Church said last night was that we get this vision of heaven. We have scripture that tells us what this looks like. And we're going to experience that one day. And I don't know about you guys, but I'm excited about that. We'll never stop praising our Lord. But what's even cooler is right now in this room, we have an opportunity to practice that before we get there. So let's do that this morning.
You are good, you are good, when there's nothing good in me. You are love, on display for all to see. You are light, when the darkness closes in. You are hope, you have covered all my sin. You are peace, when my fear is crippling. You are true, even in my wandering. You are joy, you're the reason that I sing. You are life, in you death has lost its sting. And oh, I'm running to your arms, I'm running to your arms. The riches of your love will always be enough. Nothing compares to your embrace. light of the world forever.
Awesome is that? Amen. Amen. Well, why don't y'all have a seat? Like I said before, my name is Cage Queen, and I'm the worship pastor down in Smyrna. And if you don't know who I am, it's been almost 2 years now that we've been here. And I was an intern I knew Kent, and he had told me about the internship program here at LifeHouse, and I was blessed and learned so much through that process. And then just a few months ago, I guess this past October, we launched on Sunday mornings down in Smyrna, and it's so good, and I love that I'm able to be here today, especially after we just finished the One Series, which is just about our unity in God. And so we are one church in two locations, and it's just so good. You guys are my family, and I hope you feel the same way about me. And so it's just so good just to share in worship and to share just on this journey of life with each other and other believers, right? Amen. Well, I haven't been here in a while, so I see some new faces, and welcome. I don't know if this is your first time. There are a lot of people here this morning, and so if I say good morning and welcome to LifeHouse, it's just because I haven't been here in a while, so I'm really, it's more of a welcome for me. But no, if this is your first time, I just want you to know we are so blessed to have you worshiping with us. You're going to see these guys. They're going to come forward, and they actually have a little card for you and your family. We call it our Connect card, and all that is we just ask that you would take that in just a moment and fill that out. We just ask for your name, your phone number, your email, and at the close of service, if you'll take it out into the lobby and take it to our Connect table, we actually have a special gift for you and your family just for coming for the first time today, just to show you that we appreciate you coming, and we hope that you'll come back. And I know there are a lot of awesome churches you could have chosen to worship with, so we are blessed that you chose to worship with us today. So if this is your first time to LifeHouse, would you just raise your hand high up in the air so one of these guys can get a card to you all? LifeHouse, let's welcome our guests this morning.
Good morning. Welcome to the first day of longer evenings. It's just a way to make you feel better about having a shorter morning. You know, we get to take a nice walk around the neighborhood and the daylight's still out, although this week it may require snowshoes. At any rate, my name is Pat Williams. My wife, my three daughters, we are partners here at LifeHouse Church. This is the time of our service where we worship God through our giving, our tithes, and offerings. If you're a first-time guest here today or new to LifeHouse, please feel no obligation to give, because your gift of being here is a gift in and of itself. In a moment, we'll be passing the traditional baskets. And for those of you who might be new, and if you sneak a peek in them, you might wonder how this church survives on what's in there. And that's in the large part because our partners and our regular tenders use the electronic means to automate their giving. So we're good. We have a very generous church. It's always hard to know what to say to prepare our hearts for the offering. Preparing my heart to give had always been something I struggled with growing up. Despite having parents who always set the example of tithing, I was sensitive to things being said about money from the pulpit in my early adulthood, which kind of makes this extremely ironic. Over time, by the grace of God who blessed me with a God-honoring wife, our spiritual walk led us to grow and come to understand that despite what it seemed like, it really had nothing to do with money. God doesn't want my money, doesn't need my money, he just wants my heart. I've heard it said this way: God doesn't want to get your money, he doesn't want your money to get you. God just really wants your heart. And as long as you value your worldly possessions first, how can he have that? And it's not a new issue either. You know, we go back a few thousand years, we take a look at the city of Ephesus, which was a well-off city at the time, not unlike the United States of America. You know, Timothy was sent to the city of Ephesus by the Apostle Paul to help lead the young church there. I'm going to read you just a couple of scriptures from Paul's letter to Timothy, encouraging him and giving him some instructions. And I'm going to read the commentary, because quite frankly, I'm not smart enough to interpret this, and these biblical scholars did this for us. So, 1 Timothy 6, 17 through 19 says, "Command those who are rich in this present world not to be arrogant, nor to put their hope in wealth, which is so uncertain, but to put their hope in God, who richly provides us with everything for our enjoyment. Command them to do so, to be rich in good deeds, and to be generous and willing to share. In this way, they will lay up treasure for themselves as a firm foundation for the coming age, so that they may take hold of the life that is truly life." Ephesus was a wealthy city. Paul gave Timothy instruction to those carrying riches has a great responsibility. If you've been blessed with wealth, then thank the Lord. Don't be proud and don't trust in your money. Use your money to do good. Be rich in good works and ready to share. No matter how much money you have, your life should demonstrate that God controls the wealth that he's placed under your care. We back up just a few verses to Timothy 6, 6 through 10. "But godliness with contentment is great gain. for we brought nothing into this world and we can take nothing out of it. But if we have food and clothing, we will be content with that. Those who want to get rich fall into temptation and a trap, and trap into many foolish and harmful desires that plunge people into ruin and destruction. For the love of money is the root of all kinds of evil. Now the commentary for this reads, despite overwhelming evidence to the contrary, most people still believe that money brings about happiness. Rich people crave greater riches and can get caught in an endless cycle that only leads to ruin and destruction. In spite of this, we'd still like to try, wouldn't we? How can you keep away from the love of money? Paul gives us some guidelines. First, realize that one day your riches will all be gone. Be content with what you have. Monitor what you're willing to do to get more money. Love people more than money. Love God's work more than money. And feel freely share what you have with others. Now, we consider giving back to God to help build his kingdom in honor. And as part of the body of Christ, as our part of how we're meant to help. So if you're a believer, I'd ask you this. Where's your heart? Can you relate to the struggles of the Ephesians? And if you're not yet a follower of Christ, or you're not sure about the whole church thing, or God, or Jesus, I'd ask you the same question. Where's your heart? Take some time to slow down and look at who or what's in control of your life. And I would ask you just to consider just even trying to let the God of the universe take control of your life and see where he takes you. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your church, for your people, and the opportunity to share what you've entrusted to us and others. Help us to avoid the traps of this world that can lead us to the destruction and take us away from your glory. We pray that our hearts are open to you and your will. Let us live our lives for you in all that we say and all that we do. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
name we overcome. For the
for the gift of worship, Lord, that we have an opportunity to worship you and to sing to you and to praise you, Father. God, I pray today for life change. God, I pray that that song would be a prayer, that we would remember that you are able in any season of life, in any situation we're going through, Lord, you are bigger than. God, we lift you high today, Father. I praise you just again for our gathering here. Thank you for each and every person in this room today. God, I pray for Mark as he brings our message. Father, that you would just bless him with your spirit and speak truth through him. God, please open our hearts and our ears. Allow us just to put off the distractions for just a little bit, Lord. God, that we would focus on you and that we would surrender to your word and what you have for us today. We love you. We thank you. We ask all this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Yes, you can be seated. Good morning. I invite you to turn your Bibles to Acts chapter 19. Acts chapter 19, where we will once again continue our verse-by-verse journey through Luke's historical record of the birth and the expansion of the early church and the spread of the gospel. If you're visiting, if you've only been here the past couple weeks, we've been journeying through the book of Acts for many months and weeks. We took a four-week pause to introduce our theme for this year. So basically, we're this morning picking up right where we left off 4 weeks ago. Again, Acts chapter 19. And I don't know about you, but I can personally attest to the fact that I've learned so much on this journey. And I've been motivated and inspired by the examples of real-life men and women that we've seen in this historical record. Real life men and women, it's incredible. I'm so impacted by their willingness to literally do whatever it takes to spread the gospel, to share the good news of Jesus to those who have never heard about Jesus. And my prayer is, brothers and sisters, for each one of you and for myself, that we would be motivated to be like them in our context. That we would be obedient, that we would be diligent, that we would be passionate about the good news of Jesus and about Jesus and his kingdom. For he is able. He is mighty to save. He is strong to redeem. And he is worthy of our worship. Let's read together. Acts chapter 19, starting in verse 1. And it happened that while Apollos was at Corinth, Paul passed through the inland country and came to Ephesus, and there he found some disciples. And he said to them, "Did you receive the Holy Spirit when you believed?" They said, "No, we have not even heard that there is a Holy Spirit." And he said, "Into what then were you baptized?" they said into John's baptism. And Paul said, John baptized with the baptism of repentance, telling the people to believe in the one who was to come after him. That is Jesus. On hearing this, they were baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. And when Paul had laid his hands on them, the Holy Spirit came on them, and they began speaking in tongues and prophesying. There were about 12 men in all. And Paul then entered the synagogue there in the city of Ephesus. And for 3 months there he spoke boldly, reasoning and persuading those gathered about the kingdom of God. But when some became stubborn and continued in unbelief, speaking evil of the way before the congregation, Paul withdrew from them and took the disciples with him, reasoning daily in the hall of Tyrannus. And this continued for 2 years, so that all the residents of Asia heard the word of the Lord, both Jews and Greeks. In this passage, we see a discernment of a deficiency, and a pretty big one at that. The Apostle Paul discerns that these disciples that he ran into in the city of Ephesus are missing something. And then we see that Paul didn't just keep his mouth shut when he discerned this. No, he helped them. We see that he gave them direction that led to their deliverance. In other words, they were saved. We see their salvation. And then Paul, he was so dedicated. He didn't just move on after they got saved. He said, okay, my work is done, and move on to the next city. No, he stayed in the city of Ephesus, that region, for 2 years. Paul was on mission, obeying the Great Commission. He was making disciples. Remember what Jesus commands, Matthew 28:19-20, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe everything that I have commanded you. This is what we see Paul doing, what we've seen Paul doing, and what we'll continue to see Paul doing. He was obedient. And then the third thing we see in light of this is the discipleship of a demographic. All the residents of Asia, that region, not Asia as we know it today, but a region called Asia, a part of the Roman Empire, known as Western Turkey to us today. The gospel was made throughout that whole region. And then, we didn't read verses 11 through 20, we'll get to that at the end of the sermon. And when we do, we'll see a distinction, a clear distinction that leads to devotion. We'll see the people of that region, that demographic, express sincere faith and love for God. If you'll remember the context before we dig in a little deeper, leading up to this passage, if you'll remember Acts chapter 18, the Apostle Paul's been to the city of Ephesus before, the same city that we're here reading about in Acts chapter 19, but only for a brief time. He was in and out. He was literally just passing through. And the people of that city, when they met him and they heard him share information, they pleaded with him to stay. But he didn't. If you remember, he had made a vow, a commitment, and he was sticking to that vow. But he expressed as he was leaving, if it's the Lord's will, I will return. Meanwhile, after Paul left Ephesus, a man named Apollos shows up, an impressive man from Alexandria. And thanks to some clarification from some people that were on Paul's team, Priscilla and Aquila, this man, as an eloquent and fervent speaker, he left Ephesus and went to Corinth and basically did what the Apostle Paul himself could not even do when he was there. We're told that the Apostle Paul greatly helped the believers there in the city of Corinth by shutting down, as in publicly and powerfully refuting the Jews there that were opposing the Christians, showing by the scriptures that the Christ was Jesus. This brings us to Acts chapter 19, verse 1. And so it happened while Apollos was still at Corinth, and Paul, having gone to Jerusalem and then to Antioch, he passed through the inland country and then came back to Ephesus. And there in the city of Ephesus, he found some disciples. Basically, he found some people who professed to believe what Paul professed to believe. However, Paul discerned that these quote-unquote disciples were missing something. He discerned that they were deficient in something. Something just wasn't right with them. And in verse 2, he said to them, did you receive the Holy Spirit when you believed? They said, no. We have not even heard that there is a Holy Spirit. And he said, into what then were you baptized? They said, into John's baptism. Referring to the baptism of John the Baptist. If you remember, in the beginning of some of the Gospels, we're told about a forerunner of the Messiah, Jesus, a man whom God sent to proclaim the way, to prepare the people, to get ready that the Messiah was about to show up. Paul found some disciples in the city of Ephesus. And you got to understand the context. This isn't one nation under God. This is 2,000 years ago. This is the Roman Empire. This city was filled with a lot of people, but very few of them, hardly any of them, were Christians at this point in time. Most of them had not even heard the name Jesus Christ. And so Paul, arriving in the city, finding some disciples in Ephesus at that time, is like finding a needle in a haystack, if that. Without a doubt, Paul had to be excited when he found some disciples, specifically when they told him that they were disciples. Jesus says in John 13:35, this is how you will know my disciples, by their love for one another. And I'm telling you, this is how it should be. This should be true. Jesus said, what Jesus says is true. He always tells us the truth. He says, this is how you will know my disciples. And when people are truly following Jesus and living for Jesus, no matter how different they are in other aspects, age, race, socioeconomic status, race, regardless of what the demographic is, true disciples bear witness with one another. They love one another. In my own experience, I've met Christians in other countries who don't speak my language and I don't speak their language, but it's so obvious to me that they serve and worship the same Jesus that I serve and worship and that they love him. I've met people, I remember Tim and I go way back. We worked for a secular company. It was back in my accounting days. And I could just tell he was a Christian. And I remember one time going up to him and saying, you're a Christian, aren't you? I could just tell. Christians bear witness with one another. I can tell you. Paul spends some time with these disciples that he found in Ephesus. But my guess is not very long after that, because it doesn't take very long. We're not told specifically what they did that made Paul question or what they said that made Paul question, but he questioned if they were really disciples. Paul's thinking that these disciples were not really disciples. And brothers and sisters, the truth is, and hear me on this, people are not always what they claim to be. Brothers and sisters, the truth is not all quote-unquote Christians are Christians. And it brings me no joy to say this, but I'm fairly certain the reality is true among some here in this auditorium this morning. And I don't say that condemningly. I say that from firsthand experience, because that was my testimony for many years. Jesus told his disciples in Matthew chapter 7, verse 20, when helping them to distinguish between the false and the true, he said, "You will recognize them by their fruits." That is, you will know if someone is a true disciple, that they're legit, that they're the real deal, not by what they claim to be, but by the fruit of their life. And then Jesus went on to say in verses 21 through 23, not everyone, this is the truth, this is the reality, not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven. But the one who will enter the kingdom of heaven is the one who does the will of my Father who is in heaven. And then he explains in verse 22, he says, on that day, referring to judgment day, the day of final reckoning, Jesus says, on that day, many will say to me, Lord, Lord, did we not prophesy in your name? Many will say to me, Lord, Lord, did we not cast out demons in your name? And many will say to me, and we did many, many mighty works in your name, Jesus. And Jesus says, and I will declare to those, I never knew you. Depart from me, you workers of lawlessness. And according to Jesus and the word of God, on that day it will be too late for those he refers to here. He will tell them, depart from him. And according to Jesus and God's word, they will be cast, they will be thrown into hell for all eternity. And this is described by Jesus himself as a place of weeping and gnashing of teeth. He doesn't want us to go there. He tells us what it's like. He's referring to hell. Not everyone, he says, who says to me, Lord, Lord, who calls out to me on that day, they knew about me, but they didn't know me. Not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven. Not everyone who claims the name bears the name. Jesus said, you will recognize them by their fruits. We're told later in Galatians, Paul's letter to the Galatian church, the fruits of the Spirit is born into the hearts of everyone who believes. And the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Brothers and sisters, you will recognize them by their fruits. Paul found some disciples, people who claimed to be disciples, but he discerned that they were deficient, that they did not have the Holy Spirit, which meant that they were not only deficient, it meant that they were not really disciples. They were not who they claimed to be. Now, in this case, with those that Paul found in Ephesus, as is often the case, these people weren't trying to deceive anyone. Rather, they simply did not know what Paul later explains to believers in Rome. I mean, here we do not need to be confused. Paul spells it out for us. He says in Romans chapter 8, verse 8, he says, those who are in the flesh cannot please God. He's referring to those who are not saved. Those who are in the flesh cannot please God. And then to the believers, he says in verse 9, you, however, as believers, you're not in the flesh, but in the Spirit. If, in fact, the Spirit of God dwells in you. And this is what I want to hear. I want everyone to hear Paul say. Anyone who does not have the Spirit of Christ does not belong to Christ. There's no ambiguity here. There's no room for confusion here, and furthermore, you will know them if they have the Spirit by their fruit. So I ask you this morning, brothers and sisters, believers, did you receive the Holy Spirit when you believed? Paul later wrote to the church that would come to be here in the city of Ephesus. In Ephesians chapter 1, verses 13 through 14, he says, in Christ, he's writing to believers, this is what happens. This is what is your experience. Let me explain it to you. He says, in Christ you also, when you heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, and believed in him, in other words, when you believed in Jesus, and not simply when you heard about Jesus, but when you believed in him in such a way that you placed your faith and trust in him as Savior and Lord, when that happened, Paul says, you were sealed with the promised Holy Spirit. Sealed is from the Greek word sphargizo, and I'm probably pronouncing that wrong. It's kind of a funny word, which means to be given something in a very secure manner. In other words, there's no ambiguity about it. In other words, you've got papers. When you believed, if you really believed, if you really placed your faith and trust in Christ, you were sealed. You have the right documentation. When you believed, you were sealed with the Holy Spirit. Who, verse 14, is the guarantee of our inheritance until we acquire possession of it to the praise of his glory. The disciples Paul found in Ephesus did not know that there was a Holy Spirit, let alone that he had been given. And even though John the Baptist said later that he would be given, he said, I baptize you with water. I'm thankful that my wife is here because I need a little drink of water. Even though John the Baptist said that he would be given, John the Baptist said, I baptize you with water, but he who's coming after me will baptize you with the Spirit. Understand, brothers and sisters, there are many mysteries yet to be revealed associated with our pursuit of Jesus and following Jesus and of our faith. There's simply things that we do have to accept by faith, but this, the Holy Spirit is not one of those things. He was promised. But when you believed, he was delivered. Check deposited and cleared, and money is in the bank. It's yours. No one can take it away from you. The Holy Spirit is our guarantee. According to the Apostle Paul, the guarantee of our inheritance, the guarantee of our life in him. It's tangible. You will know them by their fruit. Did you receive the Holy Spirit when you believed? Peter says in 1 Peter 1:12, make your calling and election sure. In other words, be certain. Make sure that you have the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is your ticket. It's a pass that's as good as gold or better than gold, really. And I don't say that to belittle who the Spirit is, but just to help you understand. He's your guarantee. Our guarantee. The guarantee of our calling and election, and even more to come, he's the guarantee that we are a child of God. We're told that when we're saved, we're adopted, placed into his family. He's our life, our destiny. The Spirit was promised. Jesus says in John, Jesus, who always tells us the truth, says in John 7, 38 through 39, whoever believes in me, as the scripture has said. So for a long time, this is the truth. This is the promise. Jesus is just reiterating the promise. He says, as the scripture has said, out of his heart will flow rivers of living water. Now this he said about the Spirit, whom those who believed in him were to receive. For as yet at that time, the Spirit had not been given because Jesus was not yet glorified. Brothers and sisters, what the quote-unquote disciples that Paul found in Ephesus did not know, that the Christ that John the Baptist said was coming came. He was born and he has been glorified. Philippians 2:6 says that though he, Jesus Christ, was in the form of God, he did not count or consider equality with God as a thing to be grasped or to cling to, but instead he emptied himself. By taking the form of a servant, being born in the likeness of men, and being found in human form, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God, Almighty God, Father God, has highly exalted him and bestowed on him, on Jesus Christ, the name that is above every name, so that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth. And every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. Jesus has been glorified. And the promise, excuse me, Holy Spirit, the guarantee has been given and received and will be received by all who believe and who will believe. Did you receive the Holy Spirit when you believed? Do you really believe what you claim to believe? Are you a disciple, a follower of Jesus? Did you receive the Holy Spirit when you believed? Paul says the gospel is the power of God for salvation to everyone who believes. He also says that everyone who calls upon the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, everyone who places their faith and trust in the Lord Jesus Christ as the Son of God to do for them what he could only do, what they could never do for themselves, shall be saved. Brothers and sisters, make your calling and election sure. The Holy Spirit is our guarantee. We can be sure. We can know. You can know. You got a water for me? I know you guys are praying for me, so I'll just go ahead and... You can know. You can know. Paul discerned that the disciples that he found in Ephesus were deficient and therefore not really disciples. But Paul did not simply discern that and then leave them. He didn't desert them. He didn't discard them. He didn't delete them on Facebook. He did not disregard them, deride them, or disrespect them. He directed them to deliverance. He shared the gospel with them and specifically informed them that all that John the Baptist had pointed forward to came to pass. He shared the good news with them. You can know. In Acts 19, verse 4, Paul told them, John baptized with the baptism of repentance, telling the people to believe in the one who was to come after him. That is Jesus. Later, John the Baptist's ministry, and apparently unbeknownst to the disciples that followed, that Paul found in Ephesus, he would be pointing specifically to Jesus and declaring, behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world, basically declaring, he's the one who I was talking about. Believe in him. Place your faith and trust in him. Paul spelled it out. These people, these disciples, knew they were sinners. They knew that God hated sin and that they needed to repent. They had sins that needed to be forgiven, and they did that. They repented and been baptized with the baptism of repentance. They had turned from sin. The problem was they didn't know who to turn to or what to turn to. So Paul directed them to the one, to Jesus, who was sent by God to deliver us from sin, the one sent to save. That is Jesus. Jesus says in John 14, 6, I am the way, the truth, and the life, and no one comes unto the Father except through me. I'm the one. Peter says in Acts 4:12, there's no other name. Not one other name given, made available under heaven among men by which we must be saved. Jesus was the one. He is the one who came to save and deliver men from sin and condemnation and death that otherwise awaits men. And incredibly in verse 5, on hearing this, not just with the ear, but with the heart, they heard and they believed. Faith comes from hearing. And thanks to Paul, he told them, he proclaimed the good news. And on hearing this, they were baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Baptized to show that they turned from sin and to him they became disciples. Just like that, they were quote-unquote disciples that became disciples. In verse 6, and when Paul had laid his hands on them, the Holy Spirit came upon them. Boy, did they receive the Holy Spirit when they believed. He came upon them. He arrived. He showed up. And they began speaking in tongues and prophesying what they had not received. They clearly received, no ifs, ands, or buts about it. Their calling election was sure them to them now and to Paul, now and to everyone else for that matter. The Spirit showed up. They were clothed with power from on high. The Spirit was poured out and no one had any doubt. And in the exact same way that the Spirit was poured out on the early church in Acts chapter 2, and I believe it's specifically documented in this way here to communicate by the author Luke that what was taking place there in Ephesus at that time among these non-Jewish believers and this non-Jewish church far from Jerusalem in a region known as Asia was not secondary to what happened in Jerusalem. It wasn't second tier or second rate to what happened in Jerusalem years prior, but rather the same gospel, the same Savior, the same Spirit, an extension and continuation of the work that had begun. And Paul documents, I believe, just a matter for record, if for nothing else in verse 7, that there were about 12 men in all. And all 12 men now had the Spirit. They all had Jesus. Their calling and election, their salvation was sure. How about you this morning? You can know. John wrote in 1 John 5:11, he said, and this is the testimony. This is it. God has given us eternal life. He's made a way of salvation for us. And he who has the Son, this life is in his Son. And he who has the Son has life. But he who does not have the Son does not have life. Got life? Jesus said, I've come that you might have life and have it more abundantly. Got life? That's why the name of our church, in case you're wondering, is LifeHouse Church, because when we planted this church and we loved the people of this community, but as we related them, what we saw, what we discerned, not condemningly, was that people didn't have this life. They were just existing. They were muddling through, running the rat race, and we wanted for them to find what we had found, to taste what we had tasted, to have what we had, life that God wanted to give them. Got life? You can have life, abundant life. God Jesus, God the Spirit, you can have the Spirit. Paul discerned that these disciples were deficient, and then he directed them to deliverance. And they were delivered, all 12 of them. But then when they were delivered, Paul didn't just say, okay, my work is done here and move on. Paul did not disengage. He did not desert them. These new believers were told he discipled them. He knew that salvation is not a destination. It's the beginning of a relationship. It's the beginning of a journey with Jesus. So many people think of salvation, okay, I got there, good, I'm done, I can rest easy. No, I'm telling you, it's just the beginning. And I tell you that because I don't want you to miss out. What I see, what I observe is so many people, and I was one of them, they hang out at the starting line. When we're to run, we're to follow, we're to live. Paul knowing this discipled them, and not just them, not just those 12 people. We're told that it went beyond the 12 men there. He discipled a whole demographic. In Acts chapter 19, verse 8, it says that Paul entered the synagogue there in Ephesus. That was his standard operating procedure. And for 3 months, he spoke boldly, reasoning and persuading the people about the kingdom of God, that through Jesus and only through Jesus, they could be a part of that kingdom guaranteed. But verse 9, when some believers became stubborn, not believers, but when some of those people who he was talking to became stubborn and continued in unbelief, basically they refused to believe. Basically they closed their eyes so they could not see what Paul was showing them, and they stopped their ears because they would not hear what Paul was telling them. They chose to continue, according to Luke, who's documenting this, in unbelief rather than simply believe. They chose not to receive what God wanted them to have and what Paul so diligently for 3 months laid before them. And not only that, they spoke evil of the way, that is Christianity, before the congregation. And so when that happened, Paul withdrew from them. And then he took the disciples with him, reasoning daily in the hall of Tyrannus. Believers understand that when it comes to this discipleship, you cannot take someone where you've never been. Moms and dads, if you want to disciple someone, don't just talk the talk, walk the walk. Paul took the believers with him. He walked with them. He lived life with them. He said, "Follow me as I follow Christ. Imitate me as I imitate Christ." He discipled them. And in verse 10, "And this continued for 2 years, so that all the residents of the province of Asia, the whole demographic, heard the word of the Lord, both Jews and Greeks." So when Paul found some of the disciples in Ephesus, remember, he discerned that they were deficient. But he didn't just go on his way. He directed them to their deliverance, and then they were delivered, and then he discipled them and others, a whole demographic, all the residents of Asia, heard the word of the Lord, and he spent 2 years doing that. And in the last 10 verses, we see a very clear distinction that led to devotion. The Ephesians and those in that province, that area, were an extremely superstitious people. They were known for, and in general, pursued the magic arts. They put a lot of stock in the magic arts, and they placed their faith in spells. But so much changed when the people heard the word of the Lord. So much changed as we see when they saw God working in extraordinary ways. There was a clear distinction between that which was true and that which was false. During that 2 years, and while this discipleship was going on, Acts 19:11, we're told that God was doing extraordinary miracles, not just miracles as if that wasn't good enough, extraordinary miracles by the hands of Paul, so that even the handkerchiefs or aprons that had touched his skin were carried away to the sick, and their diseases left them, and the evil spirits came out of them. But in contrast, verse 13, some of the itinerant Jewish exorcists undertook to invoke the name of the Lord Jesus over those who had evil spirits, saying, "I adjure you by the Jesus whom Paul proclaims." Verse 14, seven sons of a Jewish high priest named Siva were doing this. These seven sons did not know Jesus. They had not received the Holy Spirit, but they, wanting to get in on the action, wanted to be a part of all that, thought they could simply claim the name of Jesus that Paul claimed. But Jesus says in John 15, "Apart from me, you can do nothing." Nothing. And as such, and again, in stark contrast, as a clear distinction to what has been said about the ministry of the Apostle Paul, who had Jesus, who had the Spirit, verse 15, "An evil spirit answered those seven sons. Jesus I know, and Paul I recognize, but who are you?" In other words, the seven of you don't have a clue what's about to happen. And apart from Christ, you are powerless. In verse 16, "And the man in whom was the evil spirit leaped on them, and he mastered all seven of them and overpowered them, so that they fled out of that house naked and wounded." Who said reading the Bible was boring, right? I love that story. Sounds like a WWF like match, Seven Sons of Siva. This is history. This is real people. This really happened. Apart from Christ, you can do nothing. And I believe that this specific testimony is shared to illustrate the clear and undeniable
disconnection between distinction between the ministry of the Apostle Paul and the gospel and the false ways the people had for so long believed in and been so disappointed by, and in such dramatic ways, just like the one given. There was a clear distinction that led to devotion, and illustrated by this testimony in the seven sons of Sceva, you simply cannot just claim the name as if Jesus was some sort of genie. Jesus doesn't join our party, we join him. He doesn't follow us, we follow him. And his Spirit helps us do exactly that, and furthermore leads us to forsake and leave behind that which has left us empty and disappointed and naked and wounded and afraid. And the Spirit leads us to express love for God who loved us first, to express devotion. In Acts 19:17, we're told how God was working distinctly in contrast to everything else that was clearly not working. And it said in verse 17, that all became known to all the residents of Ephesus, both Jews and Greeks, and as a result, fear, reverence for Almighty God. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. And as the result of all that was going on, fear fell upon them all. And as such, the name of the Lord Jesus was extolled. Jesus Christ was magnified. He was high and lifted up. Clearly see that Paul was not extolled. Jesus was. And that was expressed in tangible ways. People just didn't say, I love Jesus. They showed it. Verse 18, it says, many of those who were now believers came. They came forward confessing and divulging their practices. In other words, they put their past behind them. In other words, they stopped doing what they had been doing. They changed their ways. They changed directions. And in verse 19, in fact, a number of those who had practiced the magic arts brought their books together and they burned them in the sight of all. And they counted the value of all those books and found that it came to 50,000 pieces of silver. So the word of the Lord continued to increase and prevail mightily. They were true disciples. They demonstrated that they did not put any stock in anyone else but the Lord Jesus Christ. They were willing to forsake that which had left them empty and disappointed, and showed and demonstrated by doing it in such a tangible way. They burned it. They wanted to communicate to everyone, yes, that's who I was. Yes, that's what I put stock in, but I'm burning it because I don't want you to question at all. I want you to know who I believe. I want you to have no doubt who I worship. They burned it all. We don't do that, do we? We don't forsake. Deny ourselves? Really? We like to add Jesus to our life, but leave something behind, give up something, sacrifice something? That's a whole nother ballgame. Jesus says, if you want to be my disciple, deny yourself. Forget not that he wants you to have an abundant life. Thing is, as was testified by Pat earlier in the service, God is jealous for you. He wants your heart. He doesn't need your money, your books, or whatever it is. He wants you. And anything that will keep you from him, anything that will distract you, anything that will entice you, anything that will confuse you, he wants you to burn. Get rid of it. Run to him. And don't delay. Why don't we do that? Do we really believe what we claim to believe? Did you receive the Holy Spirit when you believed? Again, I acknowledge that there is much to learn. There are many mysteries. This is not one of them. And this morning, like many of us here in this room, you can walk out that door knowing that you have a guarantee. Amen. You need not wonder. God doesn't want you to wonder. But you need to believe, and I'm talking believe. Believe that Jesus is who he claimed to be. Believe that God, motivated by love, sent Jesus to do for each and every one of you, for us, what we could not do for ourselves, and that a price was paid. Jesus suffered and died. They drove nails in his feet and hands. They put a crown of thorns upon his head. They spat on him. They humiliated him on our behalf. God made him who knew no sin, Jesus, become sin on our behalf so that we, you, I can be the righteousness, might be the righteousness of God in him. You need not be far from God. You can be near. Jesus is the way. So this morning, the challenge is twofold. For believers, I charge you to step up. What books do you need to burn in your life? What obstacles have you set on a shelf or put in the drawer or put in your back pocket that you need to burn? Do people know what you believe? You will know them by their fruit. Would people at your work, your school, be surprised to know that you are a Christian? You will know them by their fruit. And the truth is, and I say this in love, and I'm pointing the finger at me, and I can only say this because it was my own experience. I discern that there are many here this morning who do not have the Holy Spirit, and it burdens me because you can have the Holy Spirit. God wants you to have the Holy Spirit when you believe. So believe and live it out. Let's bow our heads right now and pray.